Hey everybody, I'm Maggie and I'm here with Scottish Rite Hospital's director of our hip center, Dr. Harry Kim. Welcome to our next session of Facebook Live. We're happy to have you.
Thank you very much. Excited to be here.
So last month we talked all about scoliosis, and this month we're going to really focus on hip conditions in children. So this week we're talking about Perthes disease, and Dr. Kim is one of our specialists for Perthes. So let's get started. What is Perthes disease, Dr. Kim?
Very good question. I like that question. So Perthes disease is really, it's a name of three surgeons who described this condition over 100 years ago. So Dr. Legg-Calvé and Perthes. But we don't have time to say all three, so we just say Perthes disease. So what is it? It's a condition that affects the blood flow to the ball. Can you see the ball part of the femoral head? And when the blood flow is disrupted, cells die and the bone degenerates. And over time, something that's a round structure like this becomes very flat and deformed like that. And that becomes a problem because that will lead to early arthritis, pain, disability, and patient will significantly have activity restrictions from it.
Okay, so I know with Perthes disease, there's a lot of stages that go into it. There's definitely different ages that people might onset of
right.
it. So what are the stages of Perthes disease and maybe the most common onset for
okay.
Perthes?
So, the thing about Perthes is there's so many variation, and things to keep in mind is it affects a very wide age range, like age 2, and I've even had patient age 1.5, like you know just toddlers mm-hmm. getting this condition up to age 15. So that's why it's a bit complicated because when you get it at a very young age versus when you get it at later on, then the prognosis is very different. How we treat it is very different. And the outcome is very different.
Okay.
What was the other question?
So stages of it.
Oh, yeah. So stages. I usually explain it like this. There are four seasons. There's also four stages to Perthes disease.
It's a good way to remember it.
Yeah. So I usually would like to sort of say that initial stage when the blood flow is disrupted, and then second stage when the blood flow starts to come back. But when it does that, what body wants to do is remove the dead bone. So the femoral head, the round structure, starts to degenerate, starts to collapse and deform. And then the third stage when it's rebuilt, so it's called reossification stage, and then last stage when it's all healed up. So initial stage, fragmentation stage, reossification stage, and then the heal stage, four stages.
Okay.
And depending on when you come and see the doctor, mm-hmm. obviously the treatment is going to be different, and
right.
your prognosis is different. So sooner we make the diagnosis and prevent that head from becoming flat and ugly like this, then prognosis will be better.
Definitely. When we, you know, before the child comes in to kind of get examined, let's kind of get into how common is it and what are the demographics around this disease?
Yes. So that's a key question. How common is it? It's not very common. And that leads to many problems because a lot of doctors are just not familiar with it. And you don't see it unless you specialize in you know, area of Perthes like I do, mm-hmm. that we have clinics, you know, every other week to see patients. But when you're out there, what you're going to see are common things like knee sprain or hip sprain, and you're going to treat that as knee or hip. In fact, some of these patients may have Perthes disease because they present with knee or hip pain or something that's non-specific. People,
mm-hmm.
you know, patients don't come in and say, I have Perthes disease. Patients come in because they had little injuries or a child is hurting and limping, and there are many different causes of, you know, something sort of non-specific presentation like that. And it takes sometimes delay in terms of diagnosing it.
Okay, so
which
kind
is
of
a
trial
problem.
And error trying
yeah.
to figure out what
yeah.
the symptoms are. So if you're a parent, what should you be looking for in symptoms to maybe
right.
determine, I need to go see a specialist?
Yeah. So you know your child after, you know, about a day or two, if it was a muscle pain or, you know, injury, child gets better, and then there's no problem after that. With Perthes disease, because there is underlying bone problem, what will happen is the symptoms will sort of linger on, and as child is more of a active sports,
mm-hmm.
pain gets worse, it's limping more, and it will last not just, you know, a few days, but it'll keep sustained in terms of having
mm-hmm.
the symptoms. Initially, maybe mild, but, you know, more serious over time, and it'll just be maintained. So if your child is not recovering from, you know, injury within a few days, I think it's warranted to have it checked.
Okay.
And you want to make sure that not just the area where the child is complaining, because a lot of kids will complain of knee pain, which really delays the diagnosis, because a lot of people, when they hear knee pain, they'll just examine the knee. And in children, you gotta really look at the whole leg. If okay. it's knee or thigh pain, you gotta look at the knee and the hip joint. And sometimes that's how you pick it up.
When a child is coming into your clinic specifically, what kind of exam are you doing to try to figure this out?
So the key is to really find the source of pain, and in this case would be the hip. So you gotta really do a gentle exam to figure if there's hip irritability. Because what happens with Perthes is when the bone dies and loss of blood circulation, the dead bone actually creates inflammation. It makes the hip more irritable, mm-hmm. and the child doesn't want to move it. So by doing a gentle hip range of motion and examination, you'll be able to localize the source of pain to the hip versus the knee or the muscle. Okay. And then after that, to make the diagnosis, you actually need an x-ray. You need usually two views, what we call AP pelvis and frog leg lateral x-ray. So you could see the both different views of the hip and look for the signs of Perthes.
Okay. So do we have some of those views on here?
Okay, so what I have here on the screen here is so-called the early stage. Remember we talked about four stages? So this would be an initial stage where it just looks very white. Right here, I'm not sure if that is projecting. Compared to the normal is right here. Can you see the pointer?
So the right hip, the right hip?
Yeah, can I just point it here? So this is the normal side, and this is the side that's affected. And you can see it's a little flatter here, kind of subtle, right? And what happens over time, though, is it degenerates like that, and it's becoming fragmented and flattened out. And you can see now it's really flat, but it's starting to regrow back. The issue is it's healing, but sometimes it heals with a hip that looks very deformed. And this hip is not going to function very well over time compared to something that's normal and round like that.
Okay. That's good. That's good to see. I think so. Now going into this, let's get into the treatment of this disease. We know that it's rare, and it happens at different ages. So then, what are the treatments that can?
So this is where it really gets complicated for parents, because treatment really depends on the age of the patient, the stage of the disease, and what is the hip range of motion. So just to simplify it, we usually like to divide it up into four different age groups. So children less than six when they start to have symptoms, so that's one group. Children 6 to 8, 8 to 11, and over 11.
That's
the reason why, the reason why we divide them up into those groups is the prognosis is getting worse as you get older. So anyone over 11, the prognosis in general is not good.
Right.
Not that all patients over 11 are bad, but in general.
Mm-hmm.
And it's sort of our job, and you know, those who see patients with a lot of Perthes, is to sort out who needs more aggressive treatment to prevent that head from collapsing versus who could be watched. So if you get the disease at a very young age, like under 6, in general, we know from previous studies that 80%, 85% of patients will do well even without any specific treatment. We don't have to do any kind of operation, just restricting activities, you know, jumping, high impact activities, organized sports will be enough for them to have, you know, pretty high chance of success, which is 80, 85%.
Mm-hmm.
But as you move up the age group, then if the amount of the head involved is really is substantial amount, then more aggressive treatment probably is needed. And what that is really also depends on the stage the patient presents, how much the head is involved, because there are different options. And it's trying to find or figure out which patient will benefit best from this treatment, treatment A versus B, is really what you need a Perthes specialist
to
do.
And it probably also depends on their lifestyle. If they're
how active they are, you know, how sort of quickly they want to get back into doing sports and so on. Yeah, I think that's important. And the other thing I think we want to talk about.
You talked about nutrition.
Yeah.
Is that a big component of this?
Yeah. So the I don't think nutrition causes Perthes disease, okay. but because it's a bone disease and you're trying to promote bone growth, I always go over the fact that, you know, you need to have vitamin D and calcium. And some kids are very finicky eaters, and that's where if your child, you know, doesn't eat like a variety of food,
right.
diet, you know, things that have calcium in it, like milk, cheese, then it probably would do best to have some kind of a supplementation of vitamin D and calcium.
I know one a big question for parents are, how do you handle the pain of this?
Right. Yeah. So that's a difficult question.
Mm-hmm.
What I found over time is if the child is very active, there's going to be more pain and more limping. So when a child is having pain, the solution isn't to give more stronger pain medication, because eventually you'll be giving more and more pain, and that's going to be every day. The idea is to really to sort of educate parents and the child that the joint is really inflamed mm-hmm. and irritated, and you need to kind of do less activity. And once you are able to institute, let's say, crutches or even a wheelchair for long distance and decrease the high impact activity, the pain settles down. In a lot of cases, they actually don't even need anything. I want to point out that if you take like anti-inflammatory, like ibuprofen, things like that actually affect bone healing in a negative way.
Oh, wow.
So in a way, it's counterproductive to be giving ibuprofen daily basis.
Okay.
I think if you're having pain, sort of Tylenol or ibuprofen, you know, once in a while, it's not a problem, but to give it every day may affect their bone healing.
Okay.
Yeah, it's good. It's important to note that.
Then, this is a very, as we said, not common pediatric hip condition, but what happens as they grow into adulthood? Maybe they finished Perthes, it's healed, they're good. What's the long-term effect?
So long-term effect is, we talked about four stages, so we're talking now about patients who is in so-called healed stage.
Right.
If the head is round, then it's gonna last a very long time. No, probably treatment is needed, you know, further down the line. If head is like this, then the patient, where it's deformed, it's big, it may be rubbing against the socket. There's a high chance that it will wear out. But depending on how deformed it is, if it's mild, then I think the prognosis is still good. But if it's very deformed, then there's a good chance that a patient will develop severe enough osteoarthritis, and the joint will wear out and may need to have hip replacement.
Okay.
Now, when you have that hip replacement is, you know, it's a big question.
Know.
We don't know. Yeah. In general, in your 50s, 40s, 50s, but in some patients who've been really active and the head really is flattened out, that could be as early as in their teens and 20s.
Okay.
Which is what we want to prevent. And that's why we're constantly trying to find ways that we could, you know, prevent the head from collapsing and stimulate the healing.
Okay. So that kind of leads into one of our final topics kind of talk about, which
already?
Is... Yeah, already. We're just having too much fun here. I can't. So what about research? Perthes is a very big question mark to a lot of parents, and people want to know, what have we done so far? What are we doing in the future to find answers?
Right. Great question. So because, you know, Perthes is all about trying to improve the outcome. And over the years, even though this disease has been known for over 100 years, there's still a lot of questions about what is the best treatment. So at Scottish Rite, we've actually spent quite a bit of time and effort trying to find solutions. So our research projects range from very basic science, things like, when I say basic science, is really trying to understand at the molecular and tissue level of what's happening when the blood flow to the femoral head is cut off. So we do that using experimental models, cells and things like that, growing cells in low oxygen environment. And then we also do a translational research where we're testing new drugs, testing new ways to clean up the femoral head so that we can decrease the inflammation.
Okay.
And currently we also lead the multi-center study through the International Perthes Study Group, which is organized and led through the Scottish Rite, where we're looking at what is current best treatment. Like for a 6 to 8 age group, is non-operative management better than operative management in terms of, you know, outcome of 2 years, 5 years, and even 10 years? Mm-hmm. So we're looking at different age groups and current treatments and which is better, so that we could at least, you know, agree and come up with a common treatment, whether you come here or somewhere else. And this is really a multi-center effort. So we have doctors from all over the United States and 8 other countries, and the group is still growing. And it's really exciting because previously, you know, we weren't able to get this kind of number of doctors together to work on this relatively complex problem.
Definitely. Yeah. I think this is really good information. I know that parents are really interested in it. It's a hot topic. So thank you for joining us today. It's been great having you.
You're welcome. I can't believe it's already done.
We'll have to revisit this topic again, for sure, because there's so much to talk about.
Right.
But tune in next week. We're going to continue discussing hip conditions. And thank you for joining us. Take care.